So you can tell us when we can start. We'll go ahead.
Right now we have about 103, 104 participants.
Right.
Probably can we wait for just one more minute?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, no problem. You want to wait for another 4 or 5 minutes? No issues.
We'll just wait for a minute or two. Yeah.
Sure, done.
Mr. Glenn,
yes.
formal good morning to you, and I welcome you to commence the session. I think now it is time you can go ahead and lead.
Yeah, thank you so much, sir.
Thank
you all of you. Good to see many known faces and known names and known voices, familiar voices. This is the time where you feel rejuvenated when you see and hear familiar voices. So good to see all of you. Hope all of you are having a fruitful lockdown. Hope this session will be fruitful for you. See, what I'm trying to do is just looking at innovation for the sake of innovation doesn't make any sense. What I'm trying to do in today's session is we will look at the innovations which have, helped our financial markets in the last few years, helped our investors in the last few years, and we look at what direction these innovations are taking and how you and me as a common investor or a layman or a management student can use these innovations to get better and safer returns. So the direction of the whole presentation will be innovation, how can we use it, and how can we get better results out of it. So we will look at it from a practical point of view and not just look at it from a theoretical point of view. As usual, I'm going to divide it into two parts. The first part, I just want to look at the current pandemic, the recession caused by the pandemic, the effect of it, and how long it can take. I'll take about 5 minutes just to cover that. I feel that's important in the context of what we are talking. And then we look at innovations, which in the last few months or in the last year or so has impacted our financial markets and has made the financial markets stronger, given the ability to the investor to look at multiple options, which has made the investor life easier, and how you and me can use this better, especially in times like these, where we are going through not just a pandemic, but also a financial crisis. So we will look at it from that point of view. I will not take too long in my presentation, so please do bear with me. I'm given to understand that no Zoom presentation should be more than 45 minutes. So I will try and keep the time, and then we'll spend a little time answering questions. I think that will be more productive. Yeah, I hope you can see the screen. Sometimes it takes a little time to pop up. So give it a couple of seconds, we'll be up and running. So thank you again to MBA department of Dayananda Sagar Institute. It's been a privilege to be associated with you guys. Okay, let me just start by first telling you that it is pertinent for us to compare the COVID recession with some of the recessions which has happened in the last 100 years. Now, I think as far as memory can take us, there were two recessions which come to our mind immediately. The last two, the first one being in 2001, when we saw the dot-com bubble going bust in the US. And with the dot-com bubble, a couple of the IT companies like Satyam Computers collapsed in India. So 2001 recession was typically led by one industry, which was the dot-com and a bit of the software industry led the 2001 recession. The 2008 recession was led due to the collapse of the world's probably largest investment bank, Lehman Brothers. And with Lehman Brothers, the financial system all over the world was rocking. Now, these two recessions, especially the 2008 recession, was quite severe. But the effect of the recession on India was not that great. It affected the stock markets, but didn't affect various other industries. The recession was more or less locked down, if I can use that word, it's so contextual, to one particular industry. But if you look at the COVID recession, the effect of the recession is across industries, right from a migrant laborer to a top-level executive, right from the agricultural sector to the services sector and the manufacturing sector. And therefore, it is only fair for us to compare the COVID recession, and I think most economists agree to this, that it is comparable, the COVID recession is comparable to the Great Depression, which happened in 1929. And like we all know, the Great Depression was one of the most severe things to happen to the globe during that particular time. Because the Great Depression, one should understand, just came after a similar kind of pandemic, the Spanish flu, which happened between 1918 and 1920. So within 9 years of the world going through a severe pandemic, you saw one of the worst recessions happening. The recession was so deep and so severe that I think I maybe mentioned it in the seminar or so in your college sometime back, but it was so severe that at one point of time, the American government had to put up a notice in the newspaper saying that every citizen who had gold with them, idle gold with them, which they had in their homes, they had to come and deliver it with the American government. They had to give that gold away to the American government. Failure to do that would have put them in jail for 10 years. And I think there was a fine of about $500 or $1,000. that's a newspaper cutting which is still there. So what I'm trying to tell you, the Great Depression was very, very severe. The only additional factor which the Great Depression had was a famine also, which coincided. Therefore, when we saw the locusts flying over North India, there was a fear among a lot of people that it could be so similarly eerie. But luckily, I think that problem is sorted. We had a decent monsoon so far. So I don't think the fear of famine is there. But one of the most severe reactions during the Great Depression was the fall of the stock market, when the American Dow Jones Index collapsed by 90%. But if you look at this particular graph, the collapse didn't happen immediately. It happened about 3 years after the Great Depression. Great Depression started in 1929. The stock market hit the bottom in the mid-1932. So the stock market collapsed 90%. If you follow the stock market, you would have realized we had fallen 45%. We've recovered close to about 33%. And therefore, now our net fall is only about 12%. But however, if you look at this graph, you will see that the pattern was more or less similar even at that point. You had a steep fall. You had a 50-60% recovery. You had a fall, recovery. So you had about 5 to 6 falls and recoveries before the market collapsed. So we still need to be wary of the fact that our stock market today reflects liquidity and doesn't really reflect the economic situation which we are seeing in India or around the globe. So one thing which we need to be ready for is a fall in stock markets and the pain that you see when the stock markets fall. The second biggest worry, and which is a serious issue which the Indian government has to also look at, is unemployment. The unemployment rate during the Great Depression hit a high of 27%. Which is huge. Today, if you look at the situation, America has an unemployment rate of 15%. India has an unemployment rate of about 11.12%. If you add the migrant laborers into it, estimate is close to about 20%. So one in every 5 employable Indians, including the unorganized sector, doesn't have a job today. And that is a serious concern. So unemployment is a serious concern. Economic shocks is something which is very most dangerous to the system. And we saw one economic shock happening about, and that was the price of a certain type of crude oil, the Texan crude oil price, which fell to minus $36. Now, never in the history of mankind have we seen oil prices fall into negative territory, forget even going to zero. And it was so severe and unprecedented that if you had a screen which was trading the crude futures, you would realize that the crude futures stopped trading at zero, in the sense that even though it was trading below zero, the computer software, the screen, which was making this crude trading happening, couldn't capture any negative figure because it never anticipated crude price to go into negative territory. So that's how unprecedented and how unexpected negative crude prices were. Now, this particular shock which happened affected a lot of nations. If you go to the Middle East, the pain is so severe that a country like Saudi Arabia has now not only put in a tax which they put early last year, they've doubled it. They've tripled it, actually. So Middle East countries, taxing people, tripling their tax, even though the tax is indirect tax, it severely hurts people. So that is the kind of impact it had. Luckily, low crude oil prices is advantageous for India. Maybe not for us as a consumer, because the government took advantage and increased the taxes on it. And therefore, we are paying 82 rupees. Without taxes, our cost of petrol today will be about 22, 23 rupees. But having said that, this shock was luckily something which insulated India, and India was insulated by this particular shock. But seeing economic shocks happening, one shouldn't be surprised. Please be ready. Our financial system, can have a shock or two. So we need to be ready for these kind of shocks. Just looking at unemployment and painting a picture which I saw in the Economic Times, I don't know how many of you read this article, but I feel it's pertinent to mention to you the kind of estimates or the real figures which you're seeing. Travel and tourism industry, 55 million people working, 38 million people will lose jobs. A large part of them have already lost jobs. You look at automobile manufacturing, 5 million people, 3 million will lose jobs. Hotels and restaurants, 7.3, 2 million will lose jobs. As per the latest statistics, nearly 1.5 million have already lost jobs. look at education, and that should be a little bit of a worry for all of us. 18 million people working, 4.5 million could be laid off. But look at the good news in the small red box. Educational tech is recruiting. Banking and financial services are recruiting. 1.5 lakh people they've added even during the lockdown time, just after during the lockdown time. And therefore, the two industries which will do well, and that must be good news for you. One is the health industry, because people are concerned about the health, more careful now about the health. So therefore, that industry is going to continue to do well during COVID, after COVID. The wealth industry, I feel, will get a wake-up call and do very well, because now people are more concerned about the safety of the money during this pandemic, during the slowdown. They are also concerned about using it properly, doing a good financial plan. So I think the health and the wealth industries will do well. And therefore, students of MBA, you are in a right position to make use of the openings and the opportunities in the industry of wealth, which is already opened up and is opening up further. Just in context of that, I think, we've been getting some inquiries from investment banks. I think a few days back, some of your students attended a Zoom meeting which we had with Wells Fargo. We have a couple of more investment banks, and the positions also are very interesting. I think Shivram will send you the details today. And, those who have not been placed, I think it's a great opportunity for you to look at it. It's a very nice position. It's a research analyst position. So I'm just slightly deviating, but I want to tell you to make use of this opportunity, because very, very few sectors are really recruiting as much as banking and finance. So just one last slide in this, and then we'll move on to innovation. How long can a recovery take? How long can a COVID recovery take? And if you look at this chart, I've plotted the last five recessions which the world has seen in the last 100 years. And the recession typically ends when the graph goes above zero again. And if you look at the time frame, 36 to 48 months, recoveries have minimum taken time. If you look at the light blue line, which is the Great Depression, you see that there was a recovery after 18 months, a slump again, and a recovery. So you call this a W-shaped recovery. And most economists believe the COVID recession will also see a W-shaped recovery, coinciding with the first phase of the recovery happening after 18 months. So we should be prepared for this pain anywhere between 18 months to 48 months. So that is how long this pain can last. We could see some green shoots happening after 18 months. The prediction of some, that you'll see a V-shaped recovery by August, September, is out of the window now. It is at the best, it can be a W-shaped recovery, and hopefully not a U-shaped recovery where it stays at the bottom for a long time. Now, during this time, people have started paying attention to their investments, paying a lot of attention to where they should invest and how they should invest. And therefore, I, in my view, I think one of the greatest innovations which has hit the stock market is the ETF. Request you all to kind of mute, please. Yeah. Shivram, can you mute everyone? Yeah. So one of the, I think, the most used innovation today is the ETF, an exchange-traded fund. Now, what is an exchange-traded fund? An exchange-traded fund is a hybrid between a mutual fund and a share. It is a collective investment scheme in the sense that ETF operates by collecting funds from all of us who want to invest in that ETF. And when they collect the funds, we are allocated shares or units, if you want to call it. It's typically units. But these units are traded on the stock market, unlike a mutual fund. A mutual fund declares buy and you once a day. If I go before 2 o'clock, I will get yesterday's NAV. If I go after 2 o'clock, I will get today's NAV, which is declared at 5 o'clock or 5:30 in the evening. So the ability of me to maneuver and make use of the volatility on NAV is completely not there in a mutual fund. However, in an ETF, that maneuverability is there. Another great advantage of an ETF is that you can break it up into the smallest unit possible. You can break it up into the smallest units possible. It is also available completely on the stock market platform. One can buy and sell. If you buy it in the morning, you can also sell it in the evening. And the ETF units are stored in your DMAT account. And you have a strong custodian-based backing The custodian holds the underlying asset which you buy, and that is well regulated. So I think in the last few months, the most used ETF has been the gold ETF. And therefore, if anyone is looking to trade gold, which is, I think, one of the best performing assets, it is giving you 21% this calendar year alone. From January to today, 21% absolute return. In the same period, the stock market has given us about a negative 12 or 13% return. So look at electronic gold. The most popular ETF, electronic gold ETF, is the Nippon Gold Bees. One unit of the Nippon Gold Bees is only equal to 0.01 gram. So with 43, today's price is 44.28. With 44.28 rupees, you can buy one unit of the gold ETF. The price is not only cheaper than the physical gold. When you sell it, there is no making charges, no wasted charges, and you can buy and sell it very easily. All you need to do to invest in a gold ETF is open a stockbroking account and a DMAT account with any stockbroker or with any bank, because most of the banks also have a stockbroking license, and you're ready to go to invest in electronic gold. Just to tell you the popularity of electronic gold, as of April, we had 11,000 crores, January to April, 11,000 crores invested in gold ETFs. Up to June, it's about 16,000 crores. Now, this is 16,000 crores is a huge amount considering the fact that physical gold jewelry in India sales have been completely down. More and more people are getting educated about the gold ETF, about electronic gold, and buying gold ETFs. And therefore, for the first time in the history of India, demand for electronic gold has gone much higher than demand for physical gold. So that is great news. This is traded on the National Stock Exchange, the Bombay Stock Exchange, and it's an easy, simple way to invest. And please remember that gold ETFs, or any ETF for that matter, the cost of investing is much lesser than a mutual fund. If a mutual fund, the cost of investing, including management fee, is about 1%, your cost of investment, including management fee, in an ETF is about 0.3 to 0.35%. So it is much cheaper. It's a very, very flexible platform. And as we go along, I'll show you how this ETF platform is being used by multiple asset classes to bring up products for us, which we would otherwise find very difficult to use. But I think in the current situation, the most popular, probably the best, giving you the best returns is from a gold ETF. And gold, as you know, is a great asset class to invest in during a recession. Just to, give you that confirmation, we spoke about the 2001 recession. Just before the recession, gold price was at 375 rupees per gram. And you will see that in 2005, when the recession kind of, bottomed out and things recovered, gold had reached a price of about 800 rupees. So 375 to 800 rupees. And then in 2008, when we had the Lehman Brothers collapse, gold was about 1,200 rupees. And in 2012, when the recession ended, gold was at 3,000 plus in mid-2012. So we were seeing more than 100% return. And if you look at that post the recession, when things were normal, growth was back, you would find that gold actually fell during that period. And in 2019, when the recession again started, gold started going up. So the gold has a perfectly inverse correlation to the economy. Gold goes up when the economy does badly. So I think this is still an opportunity for you to invest in gold. Even though gold has gone up 50-odd% in the last year, there can still be some upside. But electronic gold is the best way to go. Then you have another slide, slightly different alternative to an electronic based ETF. You have electronic real estate, which is available through a REIT. And what excites me is that we have a new REIT coming up in another few days' time. On 27 July, we will find the Raija Group launching their long delayed ETF, Mindspace Business Parks. And the beauty of an ETF, a REIT, is that you can even buy one unit of a real estate. Generally, one unit is priced at 1.2 lakhs. So for individuals like us who cannot ever participate into investing into an SEZ or a corporate office or a shopping mall. By the way, just for your information, rental yields in India from retail apartments, from individual apartments, is one of the worst in the world, 2.5% to 3.5%. But commercial real estate in India can give you yields of 7 to 8%. And the beauty of a REIT is by investing 1.2 lakhs, we are able to participate in this high rental yield. So if you buy one unit of a REIT of Embassy or Mindspace, Embassy I would take because that was the first REIT in India. Embassy REIT said that if you buy one unit, all you need to do is invest 1.2 lakhs and you get one unit of about four SEZs with their combined and one commercial property. So the value of all this put together was divided into units and we could buy one unit of 1.2 lakhs. We get proportional, proportional ownership in all these four different SEZs and complex. And the rental yield offered was 8.25%. And in the last 1 year, those who invested in Embassy have seen a great benefit of not only getting 8.25% yield, they've also seen an upside in the property prices. So property prices go up, you not only get your rental yield, which is paid once every quarter, you also get an increase in the value of your REIT. However, if the demand for this real estate falls, then you could see a fall in a fall in your REIT value. So the Mindspace REIT is a great REIT to go in and invest into because Raija has a lot of good SEZs, mostly IT companies, 92 or 93% IT companies. So it is a good REIT to do, invest in. However, my suggestion to you is wait for a little while because work from home from IT companies could reduce occupancy and therefore it could affect prices of REITs. So wait for a little while, but REITs are a great way for us to invest into real estate. And I believe real estate is probably a lead indicator of economic recovery. If you look at 2008 to 2012 recession, about a year before 2012, real estate started improving. The end of 2010, you saw real estate starting to boom. And by mid-2012, in 2 years, real estate prices had gone through the roof. So real estate sometimes is a lead indicator for economic recovery. I strongly believe that you will start seeing a recovery in real estate prices in a year or so, typically because we have to remember that interest rates are coming down. Housing loan interest rates are now below 7%. And it could go close to 6.5% with further interest cuts. You also going to see a property prices falling drastically because the government is now virtually pushing real estate developers to reduce prices and sell because all of them owe money to the banks. And therefore, if you look at Piyush Goyal's statement about a month and a half ago, he had warned real estate companies to sell it at cost and repay the banks. And I think if they don't do it, the government is going to come down strictly on them. So in the next few months, you're going to see home loan prices at close to 6.5, 6.7, and you're going to see real estate prices falling by 10-15%. I can already see it in Chennai. I can already see it in Bangalore that prices are falling. It hasn't fallen 15-20%, but it's fallen about 4-5%. This will continue to happen. And very, very soon, you will reach a point of equilibrium where I think investors will realize that it is better for us to jump into real estate with low interest rates and low prices. Especially people living in rented apartments will start moving to their own apartment, to their own house, because instead of paying rent, you rather own your own asset. So this point of equilibrium, I think, will reach very soon. So real estate can be a great investment. Buying physical real estate, the biggest problem is liquidity. Once we buy it, we can't sell it easily. But REITs is excellent. You can buy it today, sell it tomorrow, and get your dividend yields based on rental income. So REITs, I think, is the next big thing to happen in India. It will continue to innovate. And as long as the REITs which are listing are doing well, you will have more and more. I believe in the next 2-3 years, you're going to see about 6-7 REITs which are there in India. And REITs can cover different things. It not only covers commercial property. If you go to the US and look at the REITs listed, you have REITs for warehousing facilities. You have REITs just for shopping malls. You have REITs just for golf courses. So I think a REIT is a fantastic, an ETF kind of product, a REIT kind of product, and combine any asset. That is the beauty of it. Even within real estate, there are various different types of real estate. And it would be great to have a REIT which covers, just something like sports venues. So with the sports venue gets money, you get income. So those kind of REITs are available. You can be creative in what you do with a REIT as long as you're able to offer a decent rental yield and appreciation. So that is with REITs. Another thing with REITs, which I don't know, with ETFs, which most of us, I don't think we know, is that ETF is a great cross-border investment. If you want to invest in the United States, if you want to have, you know, indirect holding of Facebook or Amazon or Netflix and benefit from their constant rise in prices, instead of going and opening an account with an American broker and risking foreign exchange fluctuation, you have REITs. The National Stock Exchange has three foreign REITs, a NASDAQ 100 REIT, a Hang Seng REIT, and a FTSE REIT. FTSE is the UK Stock Exchange. So if we want to own shares in those countries indirectly by investing in these REITs in Indian rupees and getting returns in Indian rupees, one can have the benefit of investing abroad. And I think international REITs are going to expand. For example, in America, you have 20 odd Indian REITs, right? From the Nifty REIT to the Sensex REIT to the IT index REIT to the banking sector REIT. You have so many REITs where Americans can indirectly invest into Indian companies. And very, very soon, you know, you're going to have more and more REITs available in India to invest into countries abroad. So what this gives you is it gives you a chance to invest across the world. For because when you see a recession getting over and economies picking up, the first countries to benefit would be countries which are rich in commodities and minerals, and you can invest into those stocks by going and investing into that particular country's ETF. So this is an opportunity for all of us. Many of us don't know. And if you look at the NASDAQ fund, the returns over a 7-year period, it's compounded, is 25.39%. The Sensex is far, far below. It's only about 9% the last 7 years. And the NASDAQ has given you about 25% return, this particular ETF. So great opportunity for us to diversify our assets across the global markets using an ETF. So what we saw is an ETF platform being used for gold, an ETF platform being used for international stocks, and a semi-ETF platform used for REITs. A REIT is a kind of ETF at the end of the day, but it's slightly different because it invests into real estate. This is a Hang Seng REIT. Not a good word to use today because this REIT indirectly is for investing into China. So instead of banning in your investment into China, I would suggest invest into China because China has invested very highly into India. Nearly half of all e-commerce companies in India are owned by Chinese. So time for us to own some of their company's shares. So Hong Kong, I mean the Hang Seng ETF is an indirect way of investing into China. The ETF, like I told you, see, each asset class today is using the ETF route to appeal to the common investor. And very exciting to see the Bharat bond, which was launched last week. I think this was the second tranche. The beauty of a Bharat bond is, if an individual has to go and buy bonds of some PSU companies, good PSU companies, you have to wait for an IPO, or you have to go to the NSE and go to the bond market and search for these issues to invest, and they are not very liquid. One doesn't know the various terminology because one particular bond can have 7, 8, 9 series. So these are very difficult for an individual investor to access. But the Bharat bond gives you an offering of a bouquet of PSU bonds, which you can invest in. And you'd be surprised to know that the current yield for those who applied for a Bharat bond is about 6.21%. And you get the benefit of indexation also in terms of taxation. I think all of you know what indexation is. You can adjust your capital gains for inflation. You can adjust your capital gains for inflation. And you have a bond which is 5 years and 10 years in duration, and your yields can increase. And also if you want money urgently in between, these ETFs are listed. So you might have to sell them at a discount, but the point is there is an exit opportunity for you in case you need money urgently. So the Bharat bond ETF is an excellent way of now ETF using even debt instruments. We started with ETF using stocks, then ETF using gold, then ETF using international stocks, then a similar type of ETF called REIT, which are using real estate, and now debt instruments are using the ETF model to get to you and me. So this is a fantastic way to invest. An FD today gives you 5.5% in a good bank, State Bank, HDFC, ICICI, gives you 5.5%. And after tax, you get 5%. But here, your yield is 6.2%. So you're getting a straight 1.2% higher. And the safety also is much, much higher. For example, these are the bonds which, you know, the Bharat Bond has invested in. Export-Import Bank, Hindustan Petroleum, HUDC, Indian Oil Corporation, Indian Railway Finance, NTPC, Nuclear Power Corporation, REC, SIDBI. So quality issues. And it also gives you the liquidity aspect added to it. So these are just, you know, really fantastic innovations which have happened to the market over the last few years using ETFs. So just to continue, ETFs has been, to me, the most useful innovation. Many of us would have heard of ETFs, but how do we use it? How do, as individual investors, we use it? And how do we make money out of it, especially during the pandemic, when one is looking at other asset classes apart from shares and interest rate-based instruments? The ETF gives us an opportunity for us to invest smoothly and easily. The next, I think, important thing which has hit the stock market, and all of us have heard about it, is the word called algo trading, which simply means that you define for trading, you use a software to code this, and you are then up and running. The algo trading part of it is that once you devise this particular set of instructions, you feed it into a program, and that program is fed into your trading system every day. And trades happen but the system executes trades for you based on the algo or the instructions which you set. These algos are based on timing, price, quantity, or any mathematical model, which basically means you can have a very, very simple model which just based on price. For example, you could put in a rule which says that please buy any stock which crosses its 52-week high. Because generally, if a stock breaks its 52-week high, the momentum of the break will take it up by another 5-6%. So you could have a set of instructions saying, please buy X amount of stock or X amount worth of stock for any company which breaks its 52-week high. And please also sell it once it goes 3-4% or 5% above its 52-week high. So that instruction fed into a system will execute the trades automatically. Because as a human being, it's impossible for me to track all stocks which have hit its 52-week high. By the time I find it's hit the 52-week high, which is updated maybe about 15 minutes after it hits its 52-week high, the stock has already moved a couple of percentage points. So I miss an opportunity. Let me give you an example. For example, I can use technical analysis also to create a very simple set of instructions. Buy 50 shares of a stock, and I'm reading from the slide. When its 50-day moving average goes above a 200-day moving average. So you're looking at a particular technical issue happening, which says buy 50 shares of a particular stock when its 50-day moving average crosses above its 200-day moving average, which basically means that the short-term strength of the stock is much higher than the long-term. And you can say sell the same stock when the moving average falls below the 200-day moving average. So these are some set of simple instructions which you can build into an algo. You can also have, you know, mathematical models which are quite complex. You can have option trading strategies which are complex, which you can build into an algo. But the point which I'm trying to make is an algo is not something which is extremely complicated. It is actually a simple set of instructions which you can feed into the system. Simple arbitrage to say if you find a stock price trading at a difference of 2.5%, between NSE and BSE, buy it in the exchange where it is lower, sell it in the exchange which is higher. And all of these funds which base their product on algorithms and base their products on arbitrage use only algorithm based methods to trade. So more and more trading is happening in the algo or space. Learning about algos is fascinating. One should try and learn that. Today, basically, Python, which is the software used for algos, people who have to build their own algos and also build the software to translate that algos into an algo trading system, you need to know about the software. But more and more what is happening, especially in the US and other countries, which will slowly happen to India, is the fact that you have templates. You have someone who's made the coding. All you need to do is go and input your instructions, and the coding will take effect of your instructions, and then you can just plug it into your trading system, and you have computer-based trades. Just very quickly, the advantages of algo trading is that it can be executed at the best possible price. It can be placed in an instant. It is very accurate. Trades are, you place it at a timely, it goes in at within without a second. In fact, algo trading is also called high frequency trading. NSE actually got into trouble by giving certain people priority in terms of high frequency trading. That's an interesting case study if someone wants to do the NSE high frequency trading scam, which happened some time back. Just check into that. Your transaction costs are much lower. You have multiple checks to ensure that what you're buying or selling fits a particular algo. And there is less mistakes, human mistakes. Human mistakes cannot happen. Psychological factors which affect us. When we see on the screen, if we see 2% profit, but we know you're aiming for 5%, sometimes we just take the 2% profit and we underperform. But the computer is devoid of any emotions and therefore will wait for that 5%. Just want to show you this, and this is very interesting. In US, retail investors also engage in algo trades. Why? Because they have these templates, which I spoke to you about. 90% of the turnover in the American markets are through algos. Global average is 75%. In India, it's only about 40%. Why? Because only institutions or large HNI traders, family offices use the algo. But very, very soon, we are set to have templates which will be available for you and me at a few hundred rupees per month. We can use these templates, create our own algos, and more of us can make use of the computer to do some trade. Unfortunately, human factors taken away. The thrill of a human being making money on the stock exchange is traded away. But a human being can then put his mind to develop some mathematical models or some very, very simple algos to make money. So algo trading is a great innovation to happen, should do extremely well if we develop good set of instructions. And it is not complicated. Very soon, you and me can use it. And already, you have many of them using algos, giving it to a software company who developed them for not very high cost. I know a friend of mine who developed a very, very simple algo. He got a software company to develop a program for him. He paid about 30,000 rupees. And it's doing quite well for him. While the market has given him a negative about 13% return in the last 6 months, the algo has given him about 7 to 8% return. Very, very simple. Use a pair trading. Just to get you interested, a pair trading is simply pick two stocks in a particular industry, go long in one, go short in the other. For example, if I pick the telecom industry, I go long in Reliance, which I think will do very well because the industry itself will do well. And I pick a Vodafone Idea, which I think will be a laggard, and I go short in it. Now, when in a recession, especially during a lockdown, telecom industry has done very well. So if Reliance went up 100%, but Vodafone only went up 50%, then I make 100% return on Reliance because I'm long in it. I make a 50% loss in Vodafone because I'm short in it. Net-net, I still make 50% profit. So these kind of strategies, very simple, but logical and can work very well in an algo. Let me move on very quickly. I'm not going to spend too much time. The sovereign gold bond was a great innovation brought in by the Indian government 5 years ago. It enabled people to move away from physical gold and buy into electronic sovereign gold bonds, which are guaranteed by the government. 5 to 8 years. 5 years is minimum, 8 years is maximum. The beauty of sovereign gold bond is when you buy the gold bond, you get a discount of about 50 to 75 rupees per gram on the 24 karat gold. You also can invest, each bond size is 1 gram of gold. You get 2.5% interest. That is the main beauty of it. You get 2.5% interest every year that you hold it. And after 5 years or 8 years when you redeem, whatever the gold price is on that day, that price is granted to you. So it's a great way of not only getting interest income on your gold, but also, making capital gains on the gold. So a lot of people who are looking at use of gold for long term. For example, if you have a young daughter who you say you need this gold for after 10 years, either for the studies or for the marriage, then instead of buying gold and, storing it idle for 10 years, you buy a sovereign gold bond. You hold it for 8 years. you also get interest during this 8 year period, and any appreciation you also get the benefit of that. Depreciation, yes, of course you will have to suffer, but anyway, if you bought gold and kept it for 10 years, if gold prices went down, that physical gold would also depreciate. So therefore it made sense for a lot of people who were saving for a longer period of time. The demand is so high that now the government is launching this every virtually every 45 days. It was earlier once every, when they started once every month, then it became once every 3 months, now once every 45 days. So sovereign gold bond is a great way to invest if you have a longer term view for gold and you want the interest rate. During the sovereign gold bond launch, the government also launched a gold monetization scheme, which I thought was an excellent scheme, but for some reason failed. So if you have idle physical gold which you bought earlier, you can go to the bank and monetize it, not demonetize it, monetize it. Monetization simply means you convert the gold into cash, and that cash goes into a fixed deposit, and the fixed deposit starts giving you interest. When the period is over, the cash is again converted into gold, and you can either take it in cash with that value of gold on that particular day, or you can take it in bullion back again. So you can either take cash or you can take gold valued at that particular price on the day of redemption. But the beauty is you convert idle gold into an FD and get, earn interest at that particular time. So for some reason, banks have not promoted it and it's failed, but it's a fantastic scheme where you can, you know, generate income on idle gold. One very, very interesting innovation in the banking system, which has come up recently, which is a double-edged sword, because you can earn a much higher interest, but also it is a double-edged sword because there is a risk involved, is this additional tier one bonds. Now, one has to realize this additional tier one bonds comes from the very fact that the Basel III norms. See, one has to understand that in 2008, when the banking system collapsed, there were many banks which were tottering and were about to fail. So many governments got together, you know, financial institutions got together, and they said we need to have stronger capital adequacy norms. So in case there's a default, also the banks have enough of capital to pay off the depositors, investors. So the Basel III norms which came in, and India's adaptation of that, says that one has to have tier one capital and tier two capital. Tier one capital adequacy has to be 9.5%, tier two has to be 2%. So in general, a bank has to have 11.5% as the capital adequacy ratio. Now, raising tier two capital is basically raising, you know, through an NCD, through a bond, and so on and so forth. Tier one capital is basically equity. Now, equity is risk capital. Now, many of the banks in India, which were already doing so badly, knew it was going to be difficult for them to raise equity, because these banks were doing so badly that no one would even subscribe to a rights issue. Forget a follow-on public offer. You could see Yes Bank, that Yes Bank issue went through. It didn't get fully subscribed, 95% subscribed only. But the 95% subscription largely happened because SBI took a large chunk of it. The retail investors was only subscribed 0.6 times. So one has to look at the fact that getting equity capital in the current situation for banks which are struggling is going to be difficult. So then banks came up with something innovative, the additional tier one bonds. So the additional tier one bonds gave you about 2 to 3% more than what an FD gives you, and about 2% more than what a normal NCD of a bank gives you. However, the fine print of this AT1 bonds says that you will be treated just like an equity investor. If the bank goes bankrupt, you are not going to get any money. You are not like a normal bondholder who gets a higher hierarchy of advantage when, you know, you liquidate the bank's assets and pay off these investors. Normally, as you know, that when you liquidate assets and you pay off the investors, the first preference goes to NCDs, bonds, and then the last preference comes to equity shareholders. But the AT1 bonds are like an equity shareholder. And in fact, when Yes Bank collapsed, 10,800 crores were lost in AT1 bonds. That is when people realized that this bond is something different. There was a higher risk factor, therefore they pay us a higher return. There is a court case going on where shareholders and trustees of many mutual funds are arguing, saying that how can you treat a bondholder even worse than an equity shareholder? At least an equity shareholder today has 18 or 19 rupees value of the Yes Bank share. But 81 bondholder is completely written down, our value is zero, we get zero money. It is not logical for us to be treated even worse than a shareholder in the process of liquidation. Therefore, this case is going on. But having said that, there is about nearly 1 lakh crore of 81 bonds which are there in the system. State Bank of India, you can pick some safe 81 bonds which are unlikely to go bankrupt and lose your money. And the returns there is substantially higher than a fixed deposit. You still get your yields about 2 to 2.2% higher than a fixed deposit. So this additional tier one bonds is risky, but it's also an opportunity for you to carefully choose, knowing there is some good banks which offer these bonds. One very interesting innovation which came up in the last few months is something called side pocketing in mutual funds. See, the mutual fund industry got a big shake up when Franklin Templeton closed a couple of the debt schemes. I won't use, when bust in these schemes, because they really didn't. They had a liquidity issue in the sense that a couple of these debt schemes where they'd invested in decent corporate bonds. One was some of these corporate bonds defaulted in interest payment. Secondly, some of these corporate bonds just couldn't be sold because there was no demand, because they had already defaulted in interest payment. So no one was wanting to buy those bonds. So when you and me went to him, our debt mutual fund, Franklin Templeton simply couldn't sell it to pay us off. Now, the problem is this, that let's say that on that particular day before the default, your NAV was 20. Now, two of the 10 corporate bonds defaulted. So if you adjust the default in the NAV, let's say the NAV comes down to 15. Now, if you and me went and redeemed it at 15, we would get the 15 NAV instead of 20 NAV. And once we redeemed it at 15 NAV, our chance of any recovery of those two particular bonds is gone completely. So the investors are left in a dilemma. Either they redeem and take this 5 rupees less NAV, or they let it wait and see more of the investments into these corporate bonds go down and your NAV probably fall even further. So you are left between a rock and a hard place. You had to take a decision either of completely getting out or, wait and see what would happen. The risk was too high. So then when investors started shunning these debt funds and there was a probable scare that everyone rushed to redeem, SEBI and some of the mutual funds came up with this idea of side pocketing, which simply meant that if your NAV was 20 and it fell to 15 because of a couple of bonds defaulting, you could redeem and take out your 15 rupees NAV. And if at all the mutual fund recovers some money from these two companies who had defaulted on the bonds, if at all they pay interest later, which has actually happened, Vodafone Idea has now paid some interest. That interest can be claimed later because the defaulted bonds are kept in a side pocket. And any income from these defaulted bonds goes into the side pocket. And as an investor who's already exited, we can now dip into the side pocket and take whatever revenue comes from the bonds which have defaulted. So while you exit the fund, while you have the advantage of exiting the fund at 15, protecting yourself from any further defaults, if there's some collection of funds, money or interest from the liquidation process of those companies, or if the companies are able to pay the interest, delayed with interest, we have access to that money also. So side pocketing has made given some safety to debt mutual funds. So if you're investing in a debt mutual fund, which invests into corporate bonds or debentures, please look at debt mutual funds which have the side pocketing option, because as the financial crisis gets worse, you could see corporate bond defaults, you could see interest being delayed. So please be careful to ensure that you look at these bonds, but look at them, look at the bonds, I mean, look at the mutual funds which have the side pocketing facility. Just before I come to this, and this will be towards the end, I'm going to quickly end. Just want to give you a picture of the banking industry in India. I don't know, most of you would have read the news that the government is now planning to privatize 7 of the PSU banks, and they're going to be left only with 5 PSU banks. Now, the reason why the government is doing it, and it's a good decision, is simply because close to about 7-8 PSU banks in India are in a difficult position. Very, very soon, if this recession continues, NPAs will increase. Already about 9 to 10% of most bank loan books are in moratorium. And we don't know how many percent this is going to default. We do not know how many companies will default. I think you will really see defaults happening in the second quarter. What has happened in the first quarter really doesn't reflect what has happened to the industry, because the first quarter saw a lockdown. And when lockdown opened, pent-up demand, which was there during the lockdown, spilled into purchase of some goods and services. That is already slowed down in July. You can see across industry, everyone has said it's slowed down in July. And if it continues to slow down, you're going to see a lot of defaults. NPAs of banks will increase. The capital adequacy ratio will fall substantially. And government has to infuse money. The government doesn't have money to infuse. So I think within the next 6 months or so, government will privatize some of these public sector banks, which are weak. And then the risk is completely with the investor. However, you have that fixed deposit insurance of 5 lakhs. But otherwise, you lose the safety of a central government bank, or a PSU bank, seal or stamp on it. So with this being the situation, one has to be very careful with the banks. I always advise whoever I do a seminar with, go with banks which are reliable. As you know, in India, the government has defined 3 banks as too big to fail. That is SBI, HDFC, ICICI. If you want absolute safety, go with them. Just want to quickly give you an example. A decent bank like a Lakshmi Vilas Bank had a capital adequacy ratio of 9% eight months back. That fell 6 months back to 3.5%. And a few days back, I was quite shocked to see that it's come down to 1%. And now a bank is trying to merge with an NBFC, Clicks Capital, to increase their capital adequacy ratio and increase assets under management. So what is happening is you find banks very quickly deteriorating. So we need to be very careful. And in this scenario, you have all over the world something called neobanking, which is coming up. And I think neobanking will be the future, because neobanking is a complete digital bank. Now, being a complete digital bank, the fact that they have hardly any expenses, no offices, very few human beings working for them. Their investment is more into systems, and therefore the cost being low, they can offer you a lot of services, you know, at much cheaper prices. Just very quickly for some examples. Now, these neobanks are having a lot of interest in UK. It has boomed in South America, the Latin countries it has boomed in. For example, you can open a neobank account in 3 to 10 minutes. A bank account can be opened in 3 to 10 minutes. No paperwork, everything digital. Because the costs are low, they offer you at least 1.5% more in terms of deposits than normal banks. You can also take a loan within 15-20 minutes of processing. One looks at your credit record. They have all the information needed. They don't keep asking you information. And you can pay everything online. So neobanks is the next great thing which is going to happen. Debit cards, credit cards are all digital. There are no charges on it. One can use it when you want. One can block it when you want. And it is all digital. The fantastic thing about neobanks is you can do foreign currency transactions without any cost. You can have a neobank account in Indian rupees, in cryptocurrency, in American dollars, whatever. So neobanking is the base on which I think cryptocurrency banking or digital currency banking is going to build itself. And therefore, if you hear the word neobanking, don't be bemused. I think it is going to be the future. It is really growing. In India, I think the number of existing banks have also applied for neobanking with RBI. RBI hasn't come up with a decision, but it's only a matter of time. Also, I think you and me would have heard that the Chinese are coming up with the first government-backed cryptocurrency, a digital yuan. And I think once it comes in and start using that for trade, more and more countries will have their own digital currency. And it's a matter of time before digital currency takes over the world. The beauty of digital currency, it enables cross-border transactions without too much of forex risk. And banking also becomes much more easier. So neobanks is a bank for the future. Let's look at UK. UK has 1.9 billion worth of assets under neobanking. And it's continuously growing. It is growing by about 178 million every year. Overdrafts. Is an old concept, but banks are making use of it today to help you and me in this COVID crisis. See, an overdraft is a limit, credit limit given, and we get charged only when we use this credit limit. So a credit limit today is given to you, an overdraft is given to you based on your FD or based on your salary. And these overdraft limits are charged anywhere between 7 to 12%, 12.5%, much cheaper than a credit card. See, today, when we have any emergency, especially during this COVID crisis, we swipe a credit card because we know we have a credit limit and we can use it anytime we want. But instead of that, here's an alternate. Age-old concept of overdraft today is proactively given to you. You don't have to apply for it when you only need it. You can apply before you need it and have a credit limit and use it when you have an emergency. And it's charged at FD rate plus 1% if it's an FD-based overdraft. So you get an overdraft at 6.5%, 7%. And you get an overdraft based on your salary if you don't have an FD at a rate of about 12.5%. And that is charged only when you use it. So for any emergency usage, I believe that the overdraft, which is reinvented itself, is a great way for us to use. So that in a way is an innovation. Why I'm mentioning it is very, very contextual in the current situation. And it is something which we should use in terms of emergency. Nothing wrong in all of us getting an overdraft limit and keeping it with us. We're anyway not going to get charged until we use it. It doesn't affect our credit score. So please take an overdraft limit and keep it. In case this recession gets worse, last 3 years, we have salary cuts, we have delayed payments of salary, we have job losses, this will help us. However, just ironically, having talking about innovation, the best returns today under this current economic situation comes from age-old investments, invest in central government schemes, investment in post office schemes. And this is the last slide, I will close with that. See, very, very interestingly, some of the best returns today are coming from post office scheme and from central government schemes. Having said that, why I'm using the word central government is that state government schemes are also offering you excellent returns. But please be a little wary of the state government bonds which are being issued. Many of them are weak institutions, like the Tamil Nadu Electricity Corporation. They are offering you bonds with, I think, 8.75% return. Now, this particular institution has a huge, huge fiscal deficit. They don't have money. How are they going to pay interest? Now, they may not default because it's a central government-sponsored bond, but they will indirectly default by extending the bond. The last time they issued a bond, the three-year period was extended to five-year period. Interest were not being paid regularly. So there can be a delay. There may not be a default, but there can be a delay. There can be an extension of the bond. So careful about state government bonds. However, central government schemes offer you a number of very interesting returns. One of the highest returns today comes from a Sukanya Samriddhi scheme for a girl child below 10 years, 7.6%. So if you have a girl child below 10 years, please do invest in a Sukanya Samriddhi scheme. The second high central government guaranteed return comes from a senior citizen savings scheme of 7.4%. You can invest up to 15 lakhs. Interest is reset every quarter. So if interest goes up also, you will get a higher interest rate after a quarter or so. Very easy to invest through a post office or a PSU bank. It is available for people 60 years plus or 55 years if you've taken a VRS. Why am I telling you this? You and me, if we are slightly clever, we can invest in our parents, our grandparents, or our in-laws' name. They are absolutely safe. They are not going to run away with our money. Only thing is we need to make ourselves a nominee in case any untoward things happen. By doing this, we gain a straight half percent more than what you and me would gain if we put our money in an FD. So like I said earlier, we are going back in time, having spoken about innovation. However, currently the best investments are available in some products which are completely vanilla, non-innovative. A post office monthly income scheme gives you 6.9%. A post office time deposit gives you 6%, while a good bank gives you only 5.5%. So like I tell everyone, it is time for us to go to the bank to borrow. It is a time for us to go back to the post office to invest, because that is the trend now. So what I've tried to do over this session is to look at innovations which can help you and me. We looked at an ETF and how the ETF structure can be used by different asset classes, gold, real estate through a REIT, debt instruments through, these Bharat bonds, even stocks are there in an ETF, much cheaper than rather investing in a mutual fund. Then we looked at, algo trading in detail and how that is changing the landscape of investing and trading in shares. We looked at the innovative schemes which are coming up with banks, the additional tier one bonds, the risk and the returns. We looked at also innovation coming through a neo-banking system. cryptocurrency system, a digital currency system. And finally, we went back and said that with all the innovation and the current scenario of this recession, going back to virtually non-innovative, age-old products and investing gives you the best return. So it's a paradox, but I think a combination of both this will give us the best return in the current situation. So I hope the innovation which we spoke about makes sense, is practically usable, and all of us understand at least introduction to this, and we would make use of it in this crisis to manage our money better, to invest a little more wisely and invest a little more carefully. Thank you very much. I hope I didn't bore you too long. I think I've taken quite a bit of time. I didn't expect to do so, but I've taken more than an hour. My apologies. Open to any questions, please. You can either unmute yourself and ask the question.
Video.
You can put on chat and answer. Thank you, Narasimha sir. Thank you for your good kind words.
Mr. Glenn, I would like to just intercept here.
Yeah, it was
truly an excellent presentation. In fact, especially for most of the students and for a good number of the faculty, your explanation about ETF, REIT, algo trading, neo banking, and all that was truly good. And probably even, in fact, I am enthused to probably invite you for a detailed presentation once all this lockdown is over to our institution. Hello, Mr. Glenn.
Yes, I'm there.
Yeah. In fact, I would be very happy to invite you for a detailed presentation on the same subject once the lockdown is lifted.
Yeah, sure. That would be great.
That is nice. So, my dear students, any questions you can shoot?
Krishna Prasad, you're asking about silver ETF. Good question. Because you can see that there's a correlation between gold and silver prices. In fact, a couple of students who are doing a project under me, I actually exactly asked them to do this. Find out the correlation between gold and silver. Because history tells us after X amount of time of gold going up, silver booms. And you can see that within a few days, silver has just zoomed up. And can you make use of this opportunity? I believe silver has a long way to go. Because there is a correlation between gold and silver, but there's a lagging correlation, which means that after X amount of time of gold goes up, you will find silver going up and eventually catching up with gold in terms of the percentage return. That research and history tells us. When we have time, we could discuss that and maybe give that as some of a projects to some of your students. It's a very interesting project which all of us can make money off if we can get this correlation correctly. But the point I'm making is that yes, silver is a great investment to do. And good news is for you that silver is also going to come up with an ETF very, very soon. I expect it in a month or so. ETF is a fantastic platform, sir. There is no limit of what you can do with it. You can use any asset class and distribute it to the public through an ETF and break up those units into the smallest level possible. Whoever thought with 44 rupees you can buy gold? It's available for you now.
Mr. Glenn, a small question on real estate, REIT.
Yes.
Right now, real estate looks to be going really down, and we don't know for which long span, what long span it is going to continue. And especially in cities like Noida, Pune, Bangalore, Hyderabad, and Chennai, many of these giant IT sectors are withdrawing from their spaces.
Yes. Yes.
So that being the case, very few nodal offices and such things are going to come.
Yes.
And probably this going towards the nadir could be for a year or two or three. We really don't know. So can you please elaborate if somebody wants to...
No, completely agree with you. That's why I also made a point of caution saying, while REIT is a great investment to make, don't do it right now. Because this work from home is going to see many companies reducing their occupancy in commercial real estate, in SEZ. And therefore, rental yields can come down. What I'm reading, rental yields can come down by about 2-2.5%. So wait for some time. Let normalcy pick up. Let these occupancy rates of REITs go up a little. And then you can, enter them. That is talking about REITs. However, on retail real estate, that is, you know, individual apartments, flats, you know, villas, houses, I think equilibrium in terms of buying will come quite soon. Simply because very soon, you know, people are going to realize it is cheaper for me to take a housing loan and buy my own flat than to pay rent. Once that point is reached, you will have a glut of demand. And when the glut of demand happens, you will find real estate going back into, you know, its upward spiral. If you again go and study the correlation, see, studying asset class correlation is a fantastic thing. It's very difficult to get, you know, commerce students to do it. They don't understand it. But I strongly urge MBA students to try and do these kind of, you know, researches, because it benefits so many people who read it. I really discourage, you know, people who do this questionnaire-based research. It doesn't help anyone. It just gives you anecdotal evidence of certain things. You do research like this. Try to find a correlation between real estate and GDP, real estate and the stock market. You will find that just before you find a GDP cycle recovering back, real estate will give you a lead indication. Real estate will move up first. You look at number of recessions. You look at the recession in 2008. Interest rate prices fell. Housing prices were low. But by 2010, housing prices started booming. Why? Because people found the interest rates low. They found housing prices low. I can give you a personal example. I picked up a property in 2010. And within a year, you will not believe me, within a year, it has gone up 300%. 300%. But let me also tell you, before you think that I made tons of money, that from that particular point till now, it has stayed at 300%. It has not increased at all. So if you look at any asset class, it is a cycle. It is a cycle. The real estate now has gone through a bear phase or a flat phase for about now 7 years, 8 years to be exact, 8 years. So it is time also, if you look at these phases, that real estate has a bull phase every about 10 years. So I think in a year, year and a half, when equilibrium sets in, when demand sets in, when people see low interest rate and low real estate prices, that they're going to jump in and buy, and then you can see a good upswing in property prices. So that is in terms of retail real estate.
Thank you, sir. Thanks for your response.
Good morning, Mr. Glenn. I have a question.
Sure, sir.
I have a question.
Yes, please go ahead.
Good morning. It was an excellent presentation, a very high-tech presentation. My simple question is,
yeah,
you were asking us to look at this gold ETF.
That's right.
Okay. So you might have seen today that the gold prices have breached 50,000 mark.
That's right.
So in this kind of situation, do you feel that gold ETF is still a...
So I've been doing, you know, similar kind of presentation, slightly differently, not too much on innovation. But we were doing a presentation for a lot of, you know, colleges, institutions, even, you know, companies where people were scared about the money. And the last 3 months, I've been telling people, you know, invest in electronic gold. And people were raising this question, no, gold has gone up too much. Just for understanding that in the last 3 months, gold has gone up 14%. It's gone up 14%. So someone who invested at the point where we were saying has got 14% return. Now, from here, you may not get 15-16% return, but can you get another 10%? I think it's very possible. It is very possible. You're seeing worsening political scenarios. The American-Chinese problem will push up gold. So, yesterday's news, I don't know if you saw it, that America's closing Chinese embassies in America. You're going to have a retribution effect from China. And as American-China war gets worse, I mean, the trade war, political war, I think gold will peak. Please also remember, we are getting close to an American election. And as you get closer to the American election, you will get all kind of gimmicks. And these gimmicks could also push up gold. So, you know, I think we still have some more upside for gold.
It is also being said, okay, one more small question connected to that. It is also being said that gold may touch 85,000 in the near future. What is your view on that?
Yeah. Once more and more people start saying that, then it's a time to exit. No, Warren Buffett says that. When more and more people on the street are saying that, you know, it will go so high, then you should be start being wary.
There was also a newspaper report in Economic Times.
Yeah. I see, typically, if you look again at history, during a recession, gold is given about 100% return. Today, it is already 50-odd percent plus. So, One, at the best case scenario, you can expect, I think, another 40% more. Worst case scenario, at least 10% more. Investing in crudes crude is a derivative instrument. You can't physically take delivery of it, which means that you're restrained by time. It's a leveraged product, which means with 10 rupees, you can buy 100 rupees worth of crude. So whenever you have a leveraged product and the price fluctuates 10%, your capital gets wiped out. So I wouldn't suggest anyone, investing in crude. One is a leveraged product. It's a derivative product. Two, very, very difficult to, envisage prices of crude today, predict prices of crude, because you've had wild fluctuations. A lot depends on this oil cartel deciding the prices. So something, a commodity where you and me cannot predict where it's going to go because of various extraneous factors, better to keep away.
Sir, you may kindly see, there is a question on algo trading. What affects algo trading?
What affects algo trading? Well, there are many positive things about algo. The only negative thing about algo, the effect of algo, is that, for example, most of us will say, if stocks fall or the index falls 3% or 5%, then sell all my positions, cut all my positions. This is stop loss. So when you see the markets falling, the algo effect makes it fall heavily. For example, in a normal case, if human beings are putting orders, if it falls 3% and we will slowly sell and it may be falling another 2%. But in an algo, once it falls 3%, all the algos selling will pump into the system and that can make it fall 10%. So falls, rises in the market are accentuated by algo trading. But otherwise, depending on the instructions which you put in, depending on the research you've done before developing that instruction, algo is a great method for you to make money. Corporate bond or bond ETF? Sir, definitely a bond ETF. One is your risk is spread among, you don't put all your eggs in one basket, it's spread among various bonds. Secondly, these bonds are quality bonds. You and me individually cannot go and buy them. It's very difficult to get, it's not very liquid, very difficult to buy the right bond. The bond ETF gives you the opportunity to do it. It also gives you an opportunity to sell if you need emergency money. If you buy a corporate bond and suddenly you need money urgently, very difficult to you to sell it. You won't have that liquidity. But a bond ETF assures you that liquidity. That is a great benefit of an ETF. You can take a long-term view, but also it gives you an exit option if you need money urgently. Yes, you might have to sell it at a discount, but it's fine. Any other questions? Any student questions? You can unmute and ask. I think Roshan, have you raised your hand? Do you have a question or are you just saying hi? Shiva, can you unmute them if they have a question? I can't see all of them. I encourage students to get more involved in the financial market. Go beyond the theory which you learn in class. It's a fascinating industry. Also, there are jobs in the industry. Very few industries where there are jobs, and finance, banking and financial services, there are jobs. More in the side of wealth management, investment banking. There are more jobs there than your normal banking. So get involved in finance. Once you study finance more from the practical point of view, do some research, you will find yourself getting more and more immersed and interested in it. So please read. Reading makes you learn about the financial markets, makes you curious, inquisitive. You ask questions, you get answers, then you develop your own solutions. And your own solution, once you start using it and making money, then it becomes fascinating. You might even think of patenting it. So, it's a fascinating world to be in. It's not at all boring. Sometimes when you study theoretically, it can be a little boring, a little difficult to understand. But when you implement it practically, it's fascinating.
One should go with a caution.
Everything is about caution, sir. Life, we need to be cautious in life.
Not with the height.
With a wife also.
I think COVID-19 has taught us to be cautious.
Absolutely. in terms of taking care of our health, in terms of hygiene, in terms of, you know, managing your money. It is sort of to be cautious everywhere. I've never got so many questions on, sir, I have money in this bank, is it safe? Every day, at least 5 people WhatsApp me and ask me that. At least 5.
So you suggest that with 5 lakh is the limit, which is probably guaranteed by the government or bank. So if you have any more deposits, you'll have to distribute it accordingly in good banks.
I would suggest so, sir. Not immediately. There's nothing to panic immediately. But I think as we get closer to this, we need to do that, because we have to realize that the government is getting out of banks, which realizes cannot keep capitalizing after capitalizing after capitalizing. They've done all what they can. They've capitalized them number of times. They merged them. And still, if they are going to, you know, be banks which are weak on shaky legs, then I think, you know, what they're doing is fine. No one can save them. We have to remember that people in Yes Bank were very lucky to get bailed out, because it happened pre-COVID. RBI got State Bank to step in and save them. IDBI earlier, LIC saved them. Post-COVID, I don't think anyone will have the money or take the risk of saving any banks. It won't happen.
So there
is what happens to sovereign gold bonds after maturity? So post-maturity, you get back your money. You get back your money at the price of gold, which was on that day. Just give me one sec. The disadvantage of working from home is that your phone rings. Yeah, you can go ahead with the question. I'll just get someone to pick it up.
Sir, I take this opportunity to thank you for also parallelly giving our students opportunities, like interview opportunities in finance sector. Already one of the clues was given by Mr. Shivram, and further also he was told, I'm really thankful to you, and our students would be really highly benefited with this.
Sure, sure. We will.
Thank you very much, sir. Any more
thank
students,
you.
My dear friends, any questions from the student side? Either through the chat box, or you can unmute and ask question to Mr. Glenn Camp.
I think most of them are
exhausted,
yeah. Too much maybe to digest in a short time.
Probably it was almost at a machine gun speed. And that was really good. That was
so,
really
good. Yeah. What I'll do is we've recorded this, so I can send it to the department, and, you know, students who want it can, you know, take it from you all and just go through it at your own pace.
So please send your complete recorded.
Yeah, we will do that, sir.
Yeah. Thank you.
Is it okay to have all kind of bank accounts in a single bank? Ritu, just look at the bank. If it is, you know, the top 3 banks, SBI, HDFC, ICICI, then it's okay. If you are in banks which are, you know, probably PSU banks which are going to be privatized soon, then start being careful. I think you better to distribute. Why would a company choose to issue bonds instead of issuing stock? Well, simply for the reason that, you know, you probably don't want to dilute your shareholding. You don't want to dilute your ownership. That is one. Secondly, is that many companies in the current situation may not have takers for their IPOs, may not have takers, the issues could fail. And then once it fails, it's very difficult to then to go and do another IPO. You have to give it some time and all that. So, you know, issuing bonds is a little more attractive, because for an investor who's, you know, doesn't know the real risk behind it, we look at it this way. If I put an FD, I get 5.5%. If I put it in this bond, I'm getting 7.5-8%. So they go for that. And therefore, bond issuers have been more successful in the last few months. Very few equity issues. You saw Rosary Biotech coming up with the issue. We saw Yes Bank. Only 2 issues in the last 5 months. So investing in crypto is now not illegal in India, but it's not regulated also. So investing in crypto comes with its own risks, risks in terms of volatility in pricing, risk in terms of, you know, losing this cryptocurrency completely. Let me give you an example. I tell this everywhere. There's this American who developed this cryptocurrency about a couple of years back, 2 years, I think, 2 or 3 years back. And the cryptocurrency was very successful. It became very popular. The price went from zero to about, you know, $1,000 plus. The guy became a billionaire when he was in college itself. So soon as he got out, he got married. He had a young kid. And because he had so much money and didn't know what to do with it, he had a good heart, he came to India to build orphanages. He came down to Trichy in Tamil Nadu. The guy ate some food, had food poisoning and died. That was tragic by itself. But what was more tragic was that the server code, the password where he had stored all these cryptocurrencies, no one had it. Only he had it and it was in his head. He noted it down nowhere. And now 2 years after this crisis, no one is still able to recover those cryptocurrencies. Therefore, all those who were holding it lost money. $145 million was lost. You also have a number of cases where cryptocurrencies, they hack into servers and take it away. So this danger is always there as long as individuals or a small institution or a corporate issues these cryptocurrencies. Cryptocurrencies will be safe, will be a great medium to trade once you have governments bringing in their own cryptocurrencies, which is a matter of time. Is Indian government doing well on taxation policy? They're doing more than well, yeah. They are taxing us even in these bad times. You have to pay higher petrol prices. You have to pay higher electricity bills. GST, they gave us only 2 months in January. They made us pay everything. Just look at this. Very clever. MSMEs, they said they're giving you some 2-3 lakh crores. What have they actually done? If you read the fine print, they're giving you 20% of your outstanding as of February. So if you have outstanding collections of 10 lakhs, they will give you 2 lakhs. Now, a little what you earned in March and maybe June, April, May, you wouldn't have earned anything. You have to pay GST on 18% on that. So if they give you 20% of your outstanding as loans and virtually take 18% away from you for GST, you are left with 2%. So you could actually construe it as if they're giving you this loan for you to pay your GST. It's virtually working out that way. So government taxation policies are excellent. Whether they've given us enough of stimulus, impetus to save the MSMEs, that I think they failed grossly. Oh, 2.5% returns on gold monetization scheme is definitely low, but at least it's better than getting nothing and keeping the gold idle. Because anyway, when you redeem, they're going to give you the value of gold on that day. They would either give it to you in bullion form or in cash form. So you can go and buy that gold back. So if gold prices fall, you buy it at a lower price. If it goes up, you buy it at a higher price. But you earn this 2.5% in the period of time. So there's no loss really for you. If you kept that gold idle, you would have lost this 2.5% per year. What about investing in brokerage companies who trade cryptocurrency? Keep away, sir. It is unregulated. If there's any loss, there's no way for you to get your money back. SEBI won't help you. Keep away from companies which are offering you this cryptocurrency trading and offering you, pay, give us 1 lakh, 2 lakhs, we'll give you, do forex trading and give you money. Those are all unregulated. They are unregulated. 99% of the time, you lose your money. Initially, they'll make few payments and then suddenly disappear. Any last question? I'll just take maybe one more question. And then we can close. Okay, so if there's no questions, I think we'll close. Venkatesh, sir, thank you so much for facilitating this. Thank you to the MBA department, all the professors and students. See you very soon. And I think then we can have a more interesting session and discussion when we go a little deep into it. But continue to build knowledge, continue to build your skill, make use of the opportunities in the financial markets. Start also investing in a small way. Start investing in a small way. Use the ETF platform to invest. You can invest various asset classes in a small way. So start getting used to investing. One day, all of you will have to invest. So all the very best to the department, to the professors, and all of you. These are tough times, but eventually, this also will pass.
Thank you very much for your excellent presentation. I wholeheartedly thank you on behalf of the department, especially on behalf of our students as well as the faculty. Thank you again, sir. Thank you. Bye, sir.
Thank you so much.
Shivram, thank you for facilitating.
Pleasure is ours, sir. Pleasure is ours. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, everyone. Thank you. Thank you, Sarah. Thank you, Mohammed. Thank you, Swati. Thank you. Thank you all who said thank you. Thank you, Biswas sir. Good to hear from you. Aparna, thanks. Okay, thank you all. I have to leave. I have another presentation coming up soon. So thank you so much.